What is the sound of instantaneousness? Instantaneousness. What is the sound? How do we describe that sound? What is the sound that absolute instantaneousness is making? Is there a word for it? Is there a word for that sound? Now, if everything that is happening is absolutely instantaneous, is there really a word to describe anything? Actually, there's reason here. Well, what is the sound? What is the word for the instantaneousness? A sound? Is there a sound? Something that we can describe, absolute instantaneousness, spontaneous instantaneousness. What is that sound? Or how do we describe it? And if everything is absolutely instantaneous, then what would the description be of that? Now, let us say it is not instantaneous. Well, maybe there's a gap. We say that there's a gap. Everything is not instantaneous. The response of light is not instantaneous to our requests. So there would be something between our request and the instantaneous fulfillment of it. Well, maybe there'd be a sound for that, or a description for that gap. We could call it something. So in that case, maybe there would be words. Now let us say that actually everything is instantaneous, but we want to change that. So we're spiritually ambitious. We say, you know, we want to prove that we're greater than reality. We can change reality. And so we imagine there's a gap there. And so we believe there's a sound there, or something's there. We talk about it. We use words. We have words. We describe. Now, is that not then spiritual ambition? Using words is that not spiritual ambition? Because it's really saying there is something there. Besides instantaneousness, there's something besides instantaneousness. It's not instant. Light is not instantly responsive. There's something else. And so we're filling in the blank of that something else. Punjaji says enlightenment is easy, but everyone is preoccupied with something else. Well, we're preoccupied by filling in that blank, trying to describe it as if we could just capture it and describe it, we would know what it is. It's like everybody is saying, you know, I know what it is. I'm just trying to express it, that non-instantaneousness. I know what it is, but I can't quite express it. Well, it's hard to express what isn't there. How do we express what isn't there? How do we express silence? How do we express in words silence? Don't all words have something there other than silence? Are they? Are words the silence themselves? Then they must be pointing to something else. Why would silence need to be pointed to? And what would do the pointing? Why would instantaneousness need a description and a pointing and saying this is what it is? Well, who's doing the pointing? It's necessary to dig into this. There's something very odd about words. Our belief that we can describe, we need to describe, the idea that we need to describe, as if the light's responsiveness was not instantaneous, and that somehow we need to fill a gap in. We're trying to fill the gap somehow. But what if there isn't any gap? It seems like we have this obsession with needing to describe. We need to describe. Why do we need to describe instantaneousness? To what? One who does not have it? Well, what if all has instantaneousness? Then what is the description for? This is very puzzling. If all universal being is instantly responded to by light in a perfect way, then what is it that needs some explanation or description of this, or words? Are words there to help it along? Are words there to explain why it wasn't instantaneous? Do we need words to explain that it's instantaneous? And why? If it's instantaneous, why do we need to explain it's instantaneous? Maybe words are saying that it's not instantaneous. Inherently, words, maybe they're conveying a sense that of non-instantaneousness. Non-spontaneous instantaneousness. Maybe that's what words are conveying. Which feeds our spiritual ego, our spiritual ambition. We say someone's enlightened, we say, well, the light is with them. But then we're here, we don't need to do anything or go anywhere. It's already with you. So then it must be with everyone. So what instructions do we need to find it? If it's already with us, what instructions do we need? If we already have it, you know, what incantations, what descriptions, what words do we need to try and locate it? Maybe the effort to locate it is blindness. Why would anyone search for anything that they already had unless they shut their eyes to it? Now, I'm often asked, what is the continuity problem? Because for me, that this is the very cornerstone of the clarification that we're being shared here. And it's easy to explain. Let us say there was a realm with all these people in it. And let's say they had bodies. Let's just use this analogy. And everybody had two eyes, and everybody was perceiving and going about things, kind of like this world, for instance. Now, let's say there was someone who had this idea, this whim, and said, you know what? I want to be fundamentally different than everyone else. And they thought, well, how can I do this? And then they finally decided, you know what? I'm going to shut my eyes. and function that way with my eyes shut. Just for the whim, the heck of an adventure. I want to see what it's like to be different than everyone. So they shut their eyes, and they experience, of course, you know, totally different functioning. They can't see. They can't see anything. They don't know what anything looks like. So they go about this way for quite some time, but they actually don't really like it. They feel like, wow, this is really tough being different than everyone else. But I want to feel like I'm different, so I'm going to keep trying. And it really gets so difficult for them and burdensome, but they don't want to give it up because they don't want to admit that, you know, it was all kind of a for naught. You know, it was a sort of a very much of a misadventure. So they start saying things like, you know, I don't know why all the rest of you don't experience this closed-eyed state. It's like incredible. You can't believe how great it is. I mean, I'm just like, I don't understand why you don't try it. Just try it. You'll see how incredible it is. And see, they don't want to admit how terrible it is and how they dislike it out of kind of shame or embarrassment. So they say, yeah, it's great. Well, they try to recruit others to try this. Now they keep on this way, going on and on and on and on and on. And finally, they reach the point where they say, I just can't take it anymore. I feel like I'm missing out on everything. It's just not worth it to me. You know, it's just been my pride, my ambition that has caused me to keep my eyes shut for so long. So they decide, okay, you know what? I'm going to open my eyes. And so they open their eyes and wham! A full panorama intensity and richness of seeing is there. The light, all, everything. And they just go, wow, what is this? This is, whoa, it's overwhelming. Because they've completely forgotten what it's like to see. They've had their eyes shut for so long. So they open their eyes and it's just too much, and they wham, shut their eyes close again. And they're shaking and trembling and saying, my God, what was that? You know, scared the heck out of me. What in the world is that? And they say, you know what? I'm never going to open my eyes again. That was terrifying. That was terrifying. In fact, what was that? And they think, and they say, you know what? I think that was a dream. That was a dream or some sort of hallucination. Some sort of mental illness, but I'll tell you what, I'm never going to open my eyes again. So they close their eyes tighter than ever before, so tight. And then they're still very frightened at just how different it was to have their eyes open. And they say, you know what, I need to make sure I never open my eyes, so I'm going to take one more step. And they don't really admit this to themselves, but they say, you know what? I don't have any eyes. I don't have any eyes. There's no such thing as eyes. So when someone says, why don't you open your eyes? They say, what are you talking about? You must be crazy. There's no such thing as eyes. That's a myth. It's a myth. There are no eyes. I don't even have any eyes to open. Now, this is called the continuity fear. That they're stuck in this continuity fear. They thought they'd want to open their eyes. They opened their eyes, and it was just like way too much input for someone who's been in darkness for so long with closed eyes, who had completely forgotten what the world looked like, what everything looked like, and what the experience of having eyes, open eyes, was all about. They just freaked out completely, shut their eyes tighter, and then claimed they don't even have any eyes to open, claimed that what they saw was a dream, a myth, a dream, some sort of mental aberration or something. So dismissed everything that can be seen, dismissed seeing, went into a deep, 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 deep retreat because of the continuity fear. The difference between having your eyes shut for you know, eons, and then suddenly opening them and seeing everything that there is to see, the total richness. This is called the continuity fear. This is at the root of everyone's problem. It's the root of my problem, your problem. Everyone has the same problem. Now, let's say this someone said, there are no eyes, there's nothing to see, you're all crazy. If anyone says that, they're crazy. And they feel, still they feel very nervous and frightened and miserable. And they say, you know what, I'm falling apart. My life is terrible. I don't understand. I really have no understanding whatsoever. And someone comes to them and says, listen, what you have is called a continuity fear. Okay? It's very understandable. It's nothing to be ashamed of. Everyone has it. Everyone who has closed eyes has this. And you shouldn't try to open your eyes right away. In fact, once you accept you got some continuity fear, then you can at least accept that you have eyes. But I suggest you keep your eyes shut tight for now. And first step is to admit that you do have eyes and realize I do have eyes. The second is to say that what I saw in opening my eyes is not going to be unreal or a hallucination or a myth or a dream. It's going to be real. It's going to be real. But I don't want you to open your eyes yet. Okay? What we're going to do is we're going to very gradually and slowly, gradually ease up on the tightness of the eye closure. Just ease up on it. And every day we're going to ease up on it a little more. Every day just a little more. But don't try to open your eyes. I don't want you to open your eyes. Forget it. Because what you did was you opened them up too quickly after having them closed for so long, and then you retreated back into even more severe fear, more eye closure and denial. So very slow, we're going to go very slow here. And as you go along very slowly, you'll get more and more used to this, the faint light coming through your eyelids. And you'll start to go a little quicker, and then gradually you'll crack your eyes just the tiniest bit. So it's very fuzzy. I'm doing this right now, very fuzzy. I can hardly see anything. There's absolutely no definition of anything here as far as seeing. But I can see the light a little bit now. I'm just going to open up a little more. And now I see like through a film, filmy gauze, as it were. And I said, wow, what is this stuff here in front of me? Huh. Okay, and you say, oh, that's very, very interesting, very beautiful. But then open up a little more like this. Open up a little more. Okay, still very filmy and hazy. Okay, up a little more, open my eyes a little more. Wow. Really starting to see color here. A little more, okay. Wow, what's this? Just take your time with this. Just sit there. Sit quietly. When you open up just a little bit, sit quietly. Don't force it. Don't force it. Don't push it. Just stay. Get used to it. Get used to it now. A little bit more. A little bit more. Get used. Spend time getting used to each gradual gradation. Now they're open up more, now more, now more, now more, now fully, fully the eyes are open. But it doesn't seem like a big deal because I went through, you know, so many, many, many steps and getting used to each step. Like I say, I'm comfortable with this, I'm comfortable with this. This is the way that we need to take. This is how to deal with the continuity problem. Awakening to reality is something we need to do gradually. Now, there's been debates on that throughout history. Some of the path of gradualism, some of the path of abruptness. But remember, we don't need any effort to be what we already are. We don't need any effort to be enlightened. We only need to open our eyes to this fact that all is universal being right now. All is universal being right now. There isn't anything else. So we're going from a complete denial of this to an acceptance of it. So there has to be a graduated way where every day you wake up a little more, wake up a little more, wake up a little more. Now, what I've seen is the sudden awakening thing where you're pushed. Someone tries to force you into open your eyes. It's possible to, through stress and strain and all that, in various ways, maybe to open your eyes. Someone pries your eyes open. And you see, and it's like, ah. And then like, poof, you shut down again. Now, here's the problem with that. Is the one that pried your eyes open, you're so terrified of what you saw. If it may have seemed beautiful, but within, there's something within you that's screaming like, I'm not ready for this, I'm not ready for this, I can't function. And that pulls you down and shuts you down. And you become very frightened of opening your eyes. The one that forced your eyes open then, can then basically blackmail you into giving them all your time, your effort, your energy, and turn into a cult zombie, essentially. Because they threaten to pry open your eyes again if you don't behave. They threaten to shock you into this awake state if you don't behave. And so if you don't basically be enslaved by them and accept your enslavement happily and be willing to do whatever they want, they say, hey, I think you might need a shock awakening right now. A Shakti. I think you need a shock from the Shakti. This, from my viewpoint, has led to these cults, these guru cults and guru-esque cults, where people, they think, you know, actually, the thing is there, this is how it works. Everyone seems very happy there, and we love the guru, everything. Oh, the guru, you're so wonderful. They're worshiping the guru. What they're really happy about is that the guru is not shocking them awake. What they're really thanking the guru for is that the guru is not shocking them awake, even though they could. It's a fearful thing. It's like, wow, I feel so relieved that I'm serving the guru properly so they don't shock me awake. It's like that. Here we use the path of reason, which is gradualness. Now, gradualness can have its breakthroughs for sure. But it comes from reason, from seeing, aha, I see this, how nice. It's an organic path. It's a path that comes from within. The voice of reason is within us. It's the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit gently orchestrates our path. My path has been very gently, gentle and gradual. Nothing forced, nothing pushed. I've certainly very intense and very full of breakthroughs, absolutely. But there's no shocking. There's no Shakti involved. No shocking. No pushing, forcing awake type of thing. No. Now, these Shakti gurus, what they're giving their those who come to them, what is not really true awakening. It's not really true awakening. But it's sufficiently different than what they're used to that it frightens them greatly. And it's the being frightened greatly with a very different experience that they feel that could be forced upon them again, that they'd be forced to experience it again if they don't kowtow to the guru, ask the guru, that binds them into this cult-like devotion to the teacher, and they say, I'll do anything you want me to do. I'll you know, just ask. You need money, whatever it is, whatever it is. But just please don't, you know, throw me into that state again. I'm scared, terrified of it. And the guru says, oh, you weren't ready for it, I understand. But you know, but the meta message is, hey, if you don't give me your life, I'm gonna shock you again. And they don't get enlightened. They don't get enlightened. You never see anyone getting enlightened from these type of gurus, guruesses. Nobody gets enlightened. It's a cult. It's a trap. It's a trick. It's spiritual criminality. Kind of a form of spiritual rape, actually. You could call it that. Now, it is true that those who get into that, they themselves, their spiritual pride is directing them to such a situation, so they have an excuse not to wake up. They can continue their spiritual ambition. So they have this great excuse, I can't wake up. I'm serving this guru, and they're telling me what to do, and it's not my fault. They say, well, I'm waking up. Sure, I'm following this guru. They're actually not waking up, and they've got a great excuse. They said, no. I'm too afraid to wake up. The guru will tell me when to wake up. Of course, the guru is never going to tell you to wake up because they're getting all your energy and effort from you. So it's a codependency. It's a mutual situation, actually, as all situations are. So it's not really a spiritual rape, it's a pretend spiritual rape sort of situation, actually. They're acting as if, you know, it's a very tricky thing, isn't it? The path of reason is you have to do it yourself. And you have to say, okay, I see this, I'm looking at this. You have to be able to look at it yourself and see it for yourself. Just say, hey, what is this with words? If everything's instantaneous, then words are describing what? The instantaneousness of it? Why do we need a description? Something doesn't fit here. Why do we need a description? Who needs a description? There's some lack somewhere that a description fills that lack? I mean, what is this thing about words and descriptions? I mean, a description is words, right? Or some symbol. Symbols are like a description for what? What purpose? What purpose? Very odd. And you can see this, you know, how odd, and you look at it. Once you've taken the path of gradualism, you reach a point where you're no longer afraid of the light so much. You trust in the light so much that then you can seem to release your efforts to do anything. And without any doing, you realize what you already are. Your attention shifts off your doing onto what you already are. So you see those who have been on the path for maybe a long time, eventually getting it, eventually get it. And they may get it just smoothly and like, oh, just take their attention off of doing and describing. Doing and describing, take their attention off of that, and they're aware of all as universal being. And they're comfortable with it. And some might say, well, it's a sudden awakening. No, it's just the one more step in a gradual awakening, actually. Now, you might say, well, the spiritually ambitious, they want to get it quick to prove how great they are. that's part of it. You could also say that the spiritually ambitious want to get it real slowly to prove just how much they've done to change the light and have to slowly unchange it. You could say that too. You could look at it both ways. However, when you admit that you have a continuity problem, you admit that you've been spiritually ambitious, which has caused your continuity problem. Now, you might try and make the continuity problem seem greater than it is in order to highlight how great your ambition has been. But the truth is, your ambition has been great. You don't need to augment it, you know, through these silly games for it to be severe. So everybody has a severe continuity problem. Whether they're trying to make it seem greater or not, it's still great and severe with everyone. So it's a very safe thing to say, I have a severe continuity problem and I need to work on it every day. It's a very safe bet. You're not aggrandizing yourself by claiming you have a severe continuity problem just to prove how spiritually ambitious you are. Why would anyone want to prove that they're spiritually ambitious anyway? But we do, for some, that's part of our ambition. So repentance is a very safe path. Say, you know, I have a severe continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. And then you'll be able to find, you're able to reason very clearly then. You're not bedeviled by all these other dynamics. And the dynamics are endless. If you say the only problem I have is the continuity problem, all that other and you put your, then you say, okay, then the vision of oneness is the resolution of the continuity problem. Only the vision of oneness has value. All this other stuff has no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. You will find your focus, your concentration, your clarity will be way, way better than before. Not in terms of forcing anything, but in terms of simply being able to stay quiet better for longer periods of time. And by staying quiet longer periods of time, that gives you the time to have the breakthroughs and to adjust to these breakthroughs. And so then you're actually, your path starts going much quicker, but it still feels smooth, like nothing's being forced, because you're able to spend more time on it, actually. When we think we have all these other problems, then you're out running around trying to fix these other problems. And you don't sit quietly focused on just this one problem and the answer, which is the vision of oneness. You don't have this laser-like attention on the vision of oneness, saying, what is the vision of oneness? I've got to get that to solve my continuity problem. I don't need to get anything else, which is true. I don't need anything else but the vision of oneness. That's it. Nothing else. Zero. I'm very adamant about this. We need absolutely nothing else except this experience, the vision of oneness. That is it. All is universal being. The vision of all is universal being right now. And then we might say, wait a minute, what am I going to do? Meaning, where is there a need for description? Where is there a need then? There isn't a need. I equals need. So, you know, where is the need that I can, what, take care of? I is playing God, playing greater than God. Saying, the idea of being greater than God means I need to do something to help God out. God is insufficient. So I need to add something. I'm the one who's giving to God, adding something to God, fixing, you know, something. I need to, you know, what do I need to do in order for this to satisfy me? Meaning, what God created doesn't satisfy me, right? Which means, if I have a need, it means that what God created doesn't satisfy me. So I means God is unsatisfactory, incomplete, doesn't make me happy. And I says, well, you can't be happy without the I doing something. It's impossible. You have to have some needs. Otherwise, you're not alive. That's what I says. So being able to focus on the vision of oneness, what is it? What is it, you know, keeping us away from that? Just that I only have one problem. It's way easier to then sit for prolonged periods of time looking at this, because you feel, hey, I'm working on the one problem that I have. I have a super severe problem, and I'm fixing it. I'm curing it. I'm looking at it. I'm melting it away. I'm evaporating it. And so you stay very motivated. So it's really the royal road to what's called the royal road of repentance, really, is to admit I have a severe continuity problem. Because I've been spiritually ambitious for a long time, and very, very much ambitious, as we all have been. Anyone who's identifying with form in any way has been extraordinarily ambitious, trying to be greater than God. And so just admitting that and then saying I have a severe continuity problem because of that, we get focused in and are able to then, the path of breakthrough starts. That's what I've experienced. Before, I couldn't quite make the breakthroughs that I needed. I said, wow, there's something wrong. I started to emphasize the continuity problem. The breakthroughs started just flowing and flowing and flowing and flowing, and now they just keep coming and coming and coming every day. More and more and more profound. Because they all relate to the vision of oneness, which, and I realized that relates to my one problem. So, there's nothing else to worry about. Take refuge in the light. Trust the light. You know, trust the vision of oneness, which is the vision of light, actually. Trust in the light is what we're going towards. Trust in the light. There isn't any other problem. Our distrust in the light is our only problem. Our mistrust comes from the continuity fear. So here we're just learning to trust the light again. Learning to trust the light. The light is just there. It's not forcing anything upon us. It's just there. It's just completely passive, passively there. Especially in the vision of oneness. It's just this feeling of equal responsiveness of light. It is equal. And it does that by presence. What we see in the vision of oneness is this presence of the light everywhere. And you feel it's equally present. We don't need any action taking place. All we need to see is the all is universal being. The presence of the light is present everywhere, universally present, equally universally present. and there aren't any adjustments that need to be made by anyone, by anything. That this is what we see. We see nobody needs to make any adjustments. And this changes our outlook towards everyone. This is the vision of oneness, is you literally see, you're aware that there is nothing in the entire allness, universal allness, that needs to make an adjustment in order for the light to be present everywhere equally. The light is present everywhere equally. No adjustments need to be made by anyone. And this is this stunning, it's wonderful, but it's also, it's so wonderful, it's kind of stunning. Absolutely no adjustments need to be made by anyone or anything, anywhere. So, what we're doing here is we're closing in on the vision of oneness, really. As we accept this fact and feel the impact on us, wow, I'm just saying, wow, that's a total game changer, total game changer. And this is true always. Doesn't matter what anyone is doing, where anything is located, location, action, words, thoughts, none of it matters in the slightest bit. The light is equally present everywhere. So it's not just the realization, enlightenment, that I need do nothing. Don't need to go anywhere or do anything. It's that nobody needs to do anything. Nobody needs to go anywhere. Nothing. No one needs to make the slightest effort at all. It's the universal being allness, the universal allness, the everywhereness right now doesn't need to do a thing and never will have to do a thing in order for light to be equally present everywhere. So enlightenment is always universal enlightenment. All is universal being right now. The light is universally present right now. Not a slightest adjustment needs to be made anywhere. Now, this is a profound recognition. So, of course, it's going to be a major wow. I don't know. I've seen it several times, and I'm feeling close to it now. So what do you do, let's, for instance, when you're really close to this, which is, I'm close to it right now. I'm realize, hey, I can see this. I'm able to, you know, I'm getting it. You just sit quietly. Mood of repentance, saying I have a severe continuity problem. So let's not force things. This is called compassion. This is called forgiveness. What is forgiveness? Forgiving yourself for your spiritual ambition, which gave rise to this severe continuity problem. So you, by admitting I have this severe continuity problem, you're being compassionate and forgiving to yourself. And since what you're headed towards is the realization that no one needs to make the slightest adjustment whatsoever, you're being compassionate and forgiving to everyone. Because you will radiate this truth to everywhereness. You see, so it's both individual compassion and forgiveness and total compassion and forgiveness at the same time. So you don't get mad at yourself for not being able to grab it, to seize upon it. You just say, that's great, I have a severe continuity problem, it's evaporating, so let's just sit here without getting all shaken up or stay calm. Okay, I just looked at salvation. I could see what it is. nobody needs to make any adjustments. There's no adjustments need to be made anywhere, ever. Therefore, everything, this is a game changer. I see it. Okay, great. Don't react. Don't act. Don't have to do anything. Just sit still. Just sit still. So the sitting still is the greatest action there is, really. Because you're being kind and gentle and compassionate and forgiving to yourself, and your inner self truly appreciates it, but it doesn't want to be pushed too fast, you know. So don't try and sweet talk it, you know. It just says, hey, just be quiet. Give it the time. Give it time. Remember, it's absolutely terrified to see that no adjustments need to be made anywhere, after believing that everything has to make adjustments, always. You can't get a bigger dichotomy, a bigger, you know, seeming difference, a continuity difference than that. So there's a time when you feel this inner fear, just let it get used to what you just saw without pushing it. Don't push it. It will get used to it. And then later on, you'll find it's eager to go further. It's eager to go further. But there's a time when that eagerness dries up and your inner being has had as much as it can stand. That's when you have to be kind and gentle and don't force things. And say, hey, that's okay. I'm willing to sit here for as long as you want. That's not a problem. Don't let your mind wander off in other thoughts. Just stay with it and say, I'm right here with you. You got any questions, I'll help out. I'm right here. Keep your attention on this inner dynamic here of the continuity fear. You don't want to abandon yourself, as it were, when it's right on the verge here of accepting the truth. Don't let your inner self get sidetracked into some other activity. Keep it right here now. So the feeling of this equal presence of the light is the feeling we need to have, vision of oneness, this feeling of oneness. And there with that, no matter how anyone is acting, and we all act like, hey, I have this intense amount of processes and adjustments I need to make. I'm really working hard on them. You know, don't interrupt me. It's very difficult to look at that and then think that the light is equally present. So we have to first, the ground of our experiencing needs to be this feeling of equal presence, which is a feeling of not dying, actually. It's a feeling of not dying. This feeling of equal presence of light has to be the ground of our experience here. Otherwise, what we'll see people who seem to be acting in such a way, really weird, like, wow, what's this? And I say, oh, I need to send you light. But then you think, wait, well, the light's not equally present. You easily get in to, you know, it you just stumble and fall so easily. You're never thinking, well, how is the light relating to this person or this body or that? No, the light is equally present. That's why you see the great teachers seem to be so impersonal. And they don't seem to really, you think they're not really relating to me personally, they just don't get it. No, they get that the light is equally present everywhere. And that's what you need to get. So that's what they're leading you towards. So don't take offense if don't seem to be interested in your story of adjustments. They're not interested in it. They're interested in reassuring you that you can also see that the light is equally present everywhere right now, and that nobody needs to make any adjustments anywhere. Ever. That's what they're leading you towards. Your story of adjustments is unimportant. It's all unnecessary, entirely unnecessary. Everyone's story of adjustments are equally unnecessary and meaningless. So they seem to have this very impersonal, not interested in your story, so sort of feel to it. But they're not disrespecting anyone or anything like that. They're simply reassuring us what it is that we need to get to, and that it's fine. Getting there is the answer. We don't need some personal story of adjustments. Now, when they say forgetting yourself, what it means is you forget the story of your personal adjustments. Now, what have I done my whole life? What are my adjustments? Oh, I forgot. They call it forgetting who you are. I forgot who I am. No, you forgot the story of all the adjustments you've been making, because you realize they were all equally unnecessary. But not just yours. You realize everyone's is equally unnecessary. When you realize that everyone's is equally unnecessary, then it's easy to drop all the storylines. You don't need to be seeing that as primary. You see the equal presence of the light as the primary, is the truth. Everything else is just a silly fantasy. So people, we have trouble dropping our own story. Okay, I got to drop it. No, it's what we need to do is drop everyone's story equally. That's doable. Trying to drop your own story. Well, what about everybody else's story? Now drop everyone's story. Essentially, dropping your own story is dropping everyone else's story too. I did have experience of dropping the sense of the storied self, both mine and everyone's. And if you yourself don't have a story, how can you be focusing on someone else's? Because that automatically becomes your story too, right? So if you have no sense of story, you don't have a sense of anyone's story. So I experienced this and I said, hey, this is really cool. I like this. So we're approaching this quote-unquote loss of self, experience of no self, all these mystical things and great attainments. We're approaching it just through reason in a very kind of measured way, steady gated way. Not being, too high or too low. I'm a big baseball fan, and for like 53 years, and the great players who get to the Hall of Fame, every game, you know, they don't get too high, they don't get too low. They're reliable, they're steady, they're focused, they're consistent. And after 20 some odd years, then they look back and say, what did I do? You know, they just stay in the moment and just keep working at it. One day you look back and there's the statistics and say, wow. But you listen to them, they don't really pay attention to that. They're just fully engaged each day. And when they win, they don't get too up. When they lose, they don't get too down. When they do something really great, they don't get too up. When they do something bad, they don't get too down. They stay very much kind of even keel, steady gait. And that's every day they seem to make progress, and they do something good every day. They do something positive. And that just adds up over time. And you have a 20-year career and add up and it's Hall of Fame. So this is the right approach. A steady gated approach. And so even, you know, we're approaching this hallowed ground, you know, we're like, well, you know, it's just another day here and I'm just putting in my work here, and whatever it is, you know, is what it is. Just another game. Don't attach too much importance to it. What's more important is to keep accepting I have a severe continuity problem. I need to keep working at it. That is the center. Make that the center, and you stay humble and you don't get the jitters. When you kind of lose track of what you're talking about, go back to the continuity problem. So I have a severe continuity problem. The vision of oneness is the only value there is because it solves the continuity problem. So back to valuing the vision of oneness. It's that simple. You center yourself just like that. And then you can easily regain what you were working on before. No one anywhere needs to make any adjustments. There are no adjustments. Everyone, everywhere, every awareness has absolutely no need to make the slightest adjustment for the presence of light to be equally present everywhere. No adjustments are needed whatsoever. And I can see this, I can know this, I can realize this. This is my primary vision. This is what I see. So vision is just simply seeing this, meaning your attention is on this fact. Track. I have a severe continuity problem. The vision of oneness is the resolution of the continuity problem. Nothing else has any value to me. Okay, what is the vision of oneness? Focused again, just like that. So this is the way to accelerate this path of reason. It's the way to accelerate it. You can accelerate it. But it's still a steady gait. It's just that you walk a little further each day, actually. You stride more confidently, you take less breaks. When you start to drift off, you're able to pull yourself right back. You don't sort of get tired. I'm sitting by the side of the road, you say, no, I'm not tired, I know what I need to work on, and keep on going like that. So instead of trying to accelerate it into running, what we're doing is we're just walking quickly for a longer period of time, but we're still just walking. Which gives us plenty of time to look ahead. If we're running, we might run into something to scare us. But if we're walking, you know, not going too fast, we can see the road ahead, and we can see, is there anything there I need to slow down for, you know? And there's less fear. You don't break your stride. Whereas if you're sprinting, you might go around a bend, and it's like the perspective's too big for you. And you go, whoa, you stop, and you turn around and run back like a rabbit. That's why I say the tortoise wins the race here. The tortoise is the one that plods on steadily. And if you can just be the tortoise, you know, all day, just you'll go very far, actually. And you won't break your gait, you know. You'll keep on keeping on very steadily. Now, if I'm getting to the end of this taping, my mind tends to wander, what do I say? It's okay. I have a severe continuity problem. I have a severe continuity problem. That's why I'm not able to stay with this longer. That's okay. That's fine. No anger, no upset, no beratement, no disappointment. Just honor your continuity problem, which is really honoring yourself. Because your spiritual ambition actually came from God. It's your adventurousness. It's our adventurousness. So honor yourself. Say, yeah, it's okay. But continue on. I have a very severe continuity problem. All other problems have zero value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. And then you gently return to, oh, what's the vision of oneness? What's the vision of oneness? Well, what was I thinking of? And you can do this for hours if you have the time, maybe in the evening time. You can just spend hours on just steadily working steady, making steady progress. When you make steady progress, you know you've done a good day's work. And if you're feeling like, I didn't do enough, say, whoa, continuity problem, that's why. Severe continuity problem. Recenter. So absolutely no one needs, nothing needs to make an adjustment anywhere. Absolutely no adjustments are necessary in the slightest bit. The equal presence of the light is already a fact right now, is a fact right now. Will continue to be regardless of whatever adjustments are made. You see, when people are making adjustments and you're looking at that, you infer from that the light is not equally present. And some people are very good at dramatically making adjustments, which is inferring that the light is not equally present. Why else would they be making all these dramatic adjustments, which is their spiritual ambition, which is saying that the light isn't the light. It's been changed, which means they changed it, actually. That's what they believe. And there's all different types of these, you know, dramatic adjustments that people make. And we've probably all been in their shoes at some point, okay? We've all been the drug addict or the person who acts out in bizarre ways. We've all different. We did the whole thing. We've probably been in those shoes, everyone's shoes at some point. But we're getting out of those shoes now. But we cannot put our attention there primarily on that. It has to be on the equal presence of light everywhere, so we don't get caught up, sucked into the spiritual ambition that they're actually showcasing, saying, look at me, I need to make all these adjustments. Right? The actors, the actresses, they're very spiritually ambitious in terms of, look at all these adjustments I can make, look at all the adjustments I need to make. And then you get sucked in, pulled into their world, you know. It's like a cult, even. The whole entertainment world is like a cult, actually. We have to follow the adjustments that these celebrities are making, thinking that, you know, if they don't make these adjustments, somehow the light isn't going to be functioning for us, or this is helping the light function better for us, or something, you know. There's that feeling, like they're getting rid of this feeling of dying. If I don't follow them, I'm going to die. actually, when you follow them, you get this feeling that you are dying. And yet they string you along as if they're going to solve that problem for you, which they don't. They just give you even more feeling of dying. It's really something. Just get right back to, I have a severe continuity problem. The only resolution of the continuity problem is the vision of oneness. Only the vision of oneness has value. And then you're centered again. And all other problems have no value to you. No, all other dramas have zero value. This is the only problem you have. You have a very severe problem and you're fixing it. That's very dramatic. Don't need any other drama, actually. This is the big drama, is evaporating the continuity problem. That is the big drama that's taking place in your life. So you're not lacking for drama. There's nothing more dramatic than the spiritual path, actually. The breakthroughs are just like, wow. That's no drama in the world can capture that accurately at all. Like, really, entertainment in the world is like crumbs. It's like nothing when you... Once you've taken the spiritual path and you're starting to make these breakthroughs and you're starting to say, wow, that's a universal fact. I'm glimpsing a universal fact. How can any drama in the world of entertainment hold a candle to that? It's like holding a candle to the sun, actually. So all these people caught up in the dramas, entertainment, thinking that this, it's really big, they're really, no. They're eating crumbs, meager, stale crumbs. Because the continuity fear is so severe. Spiritual ambition still rules the roost for them. Which, because the continuity fear hasn't been recognized, they've not repented. You see, repentant people generally go, move away from entertainment. The whole Hollywood entertainment world, all of this dramatic, the news, everything is all this dramatic stuff. They tend to move away from it. They don't deny that stuff's going on in the world, all these adjustments. They are. I mean, I talk about these are a lot of adjustments are coming up. You'd better get on the path of reason and better repent. You know, that's the traditional admonition of the spiritual path is repent. Repent now. That's what Jesus told us. Repent now. Because all these adjustments of these drama queens are definitely taking place in the world. And it's you can get caught up in that. If you don't repent, you will get caught up in it. And repent is to safely say, I have a severe continuity problem. And the only remedy for that is the vision of oneness. That's it. There is no other remedy. Vision of oneness, meaning you see equal presence of light everywhere for all. Just one presence of light. There's just one presence because it's equally present. You cannot divide it up. That's why we say it's one. You can't say, well, it's more here and less over here, so we can define this as light one and define this over here as light two. There's none of that. There's only one, so why even define it? If there's only one, what's the purpose of definition? Definition is to draw distinctions between two-ness, right? This is different than this. If it's all one, there's no reason for exhalation. Thus, there's no reason for words. There's no reason for words, is there? That's why it goes beyond words. That's why Jesus titled his book, Journey Beyond Words. Journey Beyond Words to the vision of oneness. So now I've just realized that I've been able to see through the whole, you know, words thing properly, which is a huge breakthrough. So I'm just saying, okay, that's great. No big surprise. That's wonderful. I'm just kind of, you know, hanging out with that. That's all. If there's no adjustments to be made by us or anything, and light doesn't have to, light therefore can be instantaneous, life is instantaneous, light is instantaneous, what is that but from a descriptive standpoint of it, absolute stillness of words, right, of description. Of mental cogitation and conceptualization and judgment and all that, absolute stillness of that. So it will bring a stillness upon our mind, an absolute stillness upon our mind. That doesn't mean nothing is happening. It's all instantaneously happening, equally present everywhere. So there's nothing to think about, nothing to describe. No words are needed. So it's an absolute mental stillness, as it were. And yet everything is happening. And yet we're completely mentally still. The whole apparatus of the belief in attuneness and adjustments, etc., goes quiet because it's totally no place for it whatsoever. No necessity, no need for it whatsoever. So we say, okay, reason is just showing this to us that great. Honor the continuity fear. Just honor it. Realize that you see it and now it's going to fade a little bit as you kind of go through a little bit of the jitters of the enormity of such an insight. You go through some jitters. That's fine. No worries. We're not sprinters, we're more like marathoners. Spiritual path is really a marathon. And look at all the people in the world that run marathons. Well, we certainly can run a spiritual marathon. As you go towards the finish line, are getting closer, making progress on the spiritual marathon, you're more concerned about putting one foot in front of the other. You're not looking ahead. When you break focus like that, you might stumble and fall. So just say, you know what? When I cross the finish line, that's when I cross the finish line. Whenever, okay? I'm just staying here, focusing on the vision of oneness, continuity fear, 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 vision of oneness, and putting one foot in front of the other, and that's it. Do not try and peek ahead too much. That causes problems. Do not say, oh, I'm going to do so much now. Now I'm getting it, but what am I going to do when I get it? No. Continuity fear. That's dishonoring the continuity fear. I mean, I just had this enormous breakthrough. I've got the jitters, so I can't be thinking about what am I going to do when I'm able to, you know, be a big shot, you know, and all. No. Because what the fear is really saying, oh my gosh, I hope I'm not too successful. That's what it's saying. And just stick with it and say, that's okay, yeah, you don't need to be successful. Don't worry. This is not success. We got a continuity fear. How can it be success? We got a continuity fear here. So we're just quiet and but next time we come back to this subject matter, we'll feel like, oh yeah, yeah, I've been there. Yeah, I know the lay of the land. I know how it kind of, you know, how it works here when I'm, you know, I've been there and I was able to feel how to move and yeah, no problem. So each day sets up the next day. Each day builds up momentum for the next day. Don't look ahead and say, well, what am I going to do next day? Let next day take care of itself. You just stay with this continuity fear around this issue. Like, wow, I just saw why my mind can go completely still. And yet I can still be aware of everything happening. But there's absolutely no need whatsoever for the mind to be engaged in description, cogitation, conceptualization, judgment, measuring, thinking, all this stuff. It can go entirely quiet. I'll not be bothered by that, my busy mind anymore. How about that? Freedom from that, you know, horrible chattering mind. Nothing needs to be said. Nothing needs to be said. Nothing needs to be said. So what happened was just some sort of organic shift took place there. Very subtle. Don't need to describe it. Stick with nothing needs to be said. So there was something of some sort of that declaration, that very sort of somewhat powerful experience, subtle. Just like, okay, something's releasing, something's letting, I don't know how to describe it really, I cannot describe it. presumably an adjustment to letting go of adjustments. Something, it seems significant. That's all. You can say, well, it seems significant. Okay. There were no words to attach to it. It was some sort of organic, deep organic shift in the being, seemingly. Seems significant. It's like pouring Drano down your clogged drains, and the water's sitting, and then sort of a couple bubbles come up, and you realize, oh, I think that may be significant. Maybe the blockage is dissolving. You don't see the blockage, right? When you pour Drano down the drain, you don't know where the blockage is. But when you see some bubbles coming up, you say, wow, maybe the blockage is being dissolved. This is significant. But you don't know how it's being dissolved, right? You can't see it being dissolved. So it was like that. Some spiritual bubbles seemed to bubble up. I said, hey, This seems like a pretty hopeful indication, right? It's just like that. Just think of it like your all the plumbing system in your house or apartment or wherever you live, and all these blockages down there. You don't know where they are. Just that the water's not flowing down well. You're pouring Drano down everywhere, and you're starting to see some bubbles come up, and you think, you know what? This is a good sign, but you don't know what's going on really. You don't know where. How much is being dissolved, how fast, where exactly, in the, where in the pipe, or anything. But, you know, deep in the bowels of all this plumbing, you feel like there's some dissolving going on, which is good news. And you don't really know, maybe the water, and even if you got a full tub of water, even if the blockage is gone, the tub still gently goes down, right? Just gently, you just see the level just gently dropping like that. So even if the drains are unblocked, it's still going to be a gentle, soft landing into the vision of oneness. It's a soft landing into the vision of oneness. Okay, well, this has been very intense. Tremendous, tremendous. So it's evening time. I'll go in and get ready for bed and kind of chill out and see how it goes. But it's a day well ended. A day well ended. Make sure you have a day well ended. A day well ended. Fantastic. Great. Great. Very great. Okay, that's it.